Well, one whole month.
Well, I'm here. So, what did you need this time?
Well, one whole month.
What do you mean remaking Dark Souls in Skyrim wasn't enough?
Well, one whole month. Well, one whole month.
Yeah, of course it was as difficult as an actual Souls game.
Well, one whole month.
Okay, I admit it. I used God mode to get the gameplay. But don't worry, I have a master plan to prove to everyone that I don't suck ass.
Work one whole month, work one whole month.
What do you mean you can't just show them your achievements again? Was it even what I was gonna do?
Work one whole month.
What? I can't make Dark Souls harder.
Work one whole.
No, anything but that. I won't do it. You can't force me.
One whole month.
Go ahead, leak my nudes, see if I care. They're all good anyway. Oh shit, I didn't know you had that one.
Well,
fuck.
Well, one whole month. Well, one whole month.
Okay, alright, I'll do it. But the blood is on your hands.
Well, one whole month. Well.
Turn Dark Souls into a roguelike, he says. Then actually beat it, he says. Fuck. How did I dig myself into this hole? But then, no one told you to do this. You could have just shut the f- We're here now, and so we must endure this pain together. And if you're out there thinking, what the hell is a roguelike? How can it be that hard? Then have I got news for you. Well, a roguelike is really just a genre of dungeon crawler games with randomized loot and enemies. But apply that to Dark Souls, and well, let's just say we're in for one hell of a playthrough.
Enemy onslaught plus, oh my god!
And this episode of Game Changer is going to be a little different, because after this, I'm going to actually try and beat it. So stay tuned if you want to witness a 15-part series of a man slowly losing his fucking mind.
It's Brittany, bitch.
But first, we've got to figure out what exactly is going to make up our Dark Souls roguelike experience. And for that, I'm going to take it back to, admittedly, the only roguelike game I have any experience with. The Binding of Isaac. Yeah, it's not quite as horrific as that in-game. Let me explain. Basically, you play as a top-down 2D kid named Isaac, whose evangelical religious mother attempts to sacrifice him in the name of the Lord.
Isaac
escapes to the basement, and now it stands for you to battle through randomly generated levels, fighting randomly generated enemies, and nothing but your own tears as projectiles, and occasionally pee. Each floor allows you to pick up randomly generated items that have the possibility of synergizing with one another, and at the end of each floor, you're presented with a boss picked from a small pool of possible bosses depending on what level you're on. Eventually, you'll fight through the basement, into the caves, and finally end up in the depths, in which you are faced with your own previously and still murderous mother who tries to stomp you with high heels. After which, you climb into her womb. Yes. Seriously, and battle through two more floors until you fight your mother still beating fetus heart. Very symbolic. Afterwards, you can either choose to travel down to Shong and battle Satan, or up to the cathedral to fight yourself. Finally, ending up in either the dark room or the chest, in which you fight the lamb or... And if you've collected the required key pieces along your journey, you may also choose to fight Mega Satan, of which you kill in incredible fashion, and finally finish your run only to do it all again next time. Well, glad we're all on the same page now. But as far as Dark Souls goes, if you've watched my previous video, Turning Skyrim Souls-like, then you'll already know the special place that that game has in my heart. But for this video, we're specifically talking about the third of the Dark Souls trilogy. And let's just say, I've invested an hour or two into this game as well. God, I've played too many games. So okay, how can mechanics from a 2D dungeon crawler like The Binding of Isaac be applied to Dark Souls 3? Well, let's break down why Isaac is such an endlessly replayable game in the first place. To begin with, every single item you pick up throughout a playthrough is randomized, and the joy comes from finding out what synergies can be created by combining two or more of these items together. Secondly, although you always follow the same roundabout path of going from the basement all the way down to the chest, every room, enemy, and boss you face along the way is also randomized from a pool. So in short, every time you start a new game on Isaac, you're playing an entirely new game. So now take these mechanics and apply them to Dark Souls. Yep, that means random bosses and random items. God, why am I doing this? Now usually to begin with, I'll select some visual mods in order to suit the tone we're trying to create. However, the visuals, for once, actually have nothing to do with it. A roguelike isn't really defined by their graphical tone, nor its gameplay in honesty. It's more about the game's system and the way the entire experience is randomly generated. But who doesn't like a good before and after anyway? So here's some generic graphical mods I've applied just to elevate our game, so in between bashing my skull on a wall, I can occasionally stop and take in the view. Unlike a game like Skyrim, Dark Souls 3 isn't 10 years old, so the difference here isn't huge. But we don't need huge. It isn't about how the game looks, it's about the way the game systems are designed. Now, admittedly, I haven't much experience with modding Dark Souls 3. In fact, I've only just bought the game on PC solely for the purpose of this video. But modding in general is more or less just drag and drop the files into the game's directory, so can't be that difficult. Turns out, no it wasn't. This might honestly be the most simple to try for yourself game change I'll ever do. After modding Fallout 4 and Skyrim for hours and hours, configuring load orders and compatibilities, finding the smallest little mods who had the tiniest gameplay change. For this episode, we've got two mods. Why is the simplest one to set up going to be the hardest to play? Oh, how ironic. I'm using Dark Souls 3 Static Item Randomizer by The Fifth Mat and Stray Souls Enemy Randomizer by Jackson. Both these mods do what they say in the title, and together completely randomize every enemy you face and every item you pick up. We now, in theory, have a setup for Dark Souls 3 that has completely random starting classes, items, and enemies. I say in theory because I haven't actually fully played it yet. I've tested it, and it seems to be working alright. But if you want to see me actually try and tackle this monstrosity, then subscribe and stick around to witness my inevitable mental downfall over the coming weeks. Those videos will take a lot less time to make, so should be posted rather frequently in between the other Game Change episodes. But if you only watch these bigger videos, then if I seem like I've completely lost it by the next episode, then you know why. Oh shit, that's the end of the script. Fuck. This is the part where I'm actually meant to try it out. Shit, okay. I'll pass you on now to Future Dan, who hopefully will actually be able to get through the tutorial. So we're here in the randomizer, and I thought, who best to tackle this monstrosity of an idea than Fat Thor? Yes, this Donnie. So, as far as I'm aware, the classes are also randomized? Oh, Jesus. Oh, God. No. Why have I never seen that armor before? What is that? Oh, good God. Okay. Oh my, what is that? Come on. Okay. Fat Thor, innit? And, I think we've got him, boys. This is our Dark Souls 3 randomizer. Okay. God, what have I created? Oh, we're not going to have to... Oh, we can two-hand it. Oh, dear. This is the face of a man who's about to be tortured for the next 4 weeks. Okay, so let's see what's going on in here. Okay, so already we've got a crow dude. Who's brilliant. I see a crystal lizard thing over there. You look the same. Okay, let's just try and get rid of this dude before he transforms. Oh, he trans... Oh no. This is going to be harder than I expected. And I expected hard. Let's just give you a bit of a 1-2 and then get back. So the problem is, we're going to run into is a lot of the enemies are going to be quite later in the game, and we're not going to have enough stamina to deal with them. You know, take our time, and we'll be... God, he bleeds quick. Nope. Nope. Okay. Brilliant. What have I done? What have I done? Let's try and give him a bit of a... That was dreadful. Oh, we were on... Okay, we've got a fire sword now. That'll work. Come on, get over it. That helps. That helps a lot. Okay. One down. And it only took us 3 lives. Oh, okay. You should not be a problem. Already done. Right, and also the items obviously are randomized. So let's see what we've got around here. Okay. Right. So I'm assuming this... I've soft-locked the main quest item, so I'm assuming this is still going to be the Ashenestus flask. Yes, it is. Okay, that's a good sign. That means it's working. Because else, when we need keys to go to certain places and things like that, it wasn't going to work. And also, what if we didn't get the coiled sword from the Gundyr fight? That would have been an issue as well, so we're glad to get that sorted. Now I hear a dog, and it's right behind me. Okay. Who aggroed that Donnie? Yeah, you can just be gone. Is he? Okay, he's walking back. That's fine. We'll tackle you in a moment, brother. We're taking our time here. Oh no. So what I'm really looking for, if we're going to survive this, is just a random item somewhere that gives us, like, the Soul of Cinder or something. So we can just straight up level up about 20 times, and then we're good. So we don't actually need to fight any of these dudes. Why is he aggro from so far away? Let's just go check out what he would actually be over here. And he is indeed an undead, which is lucky for us. And a very weak one. Brilliant. I'll take a titanite chunk straight at the start of the game. Not complaining one bit. An undead lesion gauntlets. Okay. I mean, we're going to give this crystal lizard a go. But I'm not sure what variant of Crystal Lizards is going to be. The one that actually spawns over there would not be a problem because we'd probably rip him a new one. But if he's one of the ones from the later game that have a ridiculous amount of health, then good luck to me. Oh, he has some health. We can do this though. It's only a problem. Got to watch our stamina. Okay, I didn't watch that though. Let's just stay safe. We've got a bonfire coming up. We can use all our Estus. Okay, let's not be dumb. Uh-oh. Okay. Great.
Listen, it's been a while since I've played Dark Souls.
Oh, we've got to go through these dudes again. If we can stagger him, that would be nice. Like that. So I'm doing something. I don't know how much that did to him. That did enough. That was dumb. Let's... Okay, we're somewhere. We're in a corner. This is bad. That helped somehow. I don't know how close he is. No! No! He was done for! So, when there's an opportunity to just walk past them, Thor's gonna take it. Well, he's dead, so that works. Frog song of a wary one. Titanite scale! Okay. You give me those. You give me those all you want. I ain't complaining. So one thing to note, which is a bit of a shame, is as this mod is still under development and the way Dark Souls 3 is made in comparison to Dark Souls 1, for instance, is it's not really possible yet to randomize the bosses correctly. So what they actually do to work around this is they duplicate the boss and then they randomize its duplication. So that's why you see just an undead man in there as well as Gundyr. So every boss, we're going to have the actual boss and then something else in there which can also be a boss. So you could get two bosses at once that you have to beat. Which is, you know, great. Okay. Fantastic.